Memorials have been held across Australia and Indonesia, remembering the night terror touched a holiday paradise. It has been 20 years since the Bali bombings, a series of explosions that killed 202 people, including 88 Australians. Now, we begin our coverage tonight in Bali, where survivors have made the pilgrimage back to the site where their lives and two countries were changed forever.
On this exact day, 20 years ago, Perth's Kingsley Cats footy team flew to Bali with their coach, Simon Quayle.
I think we're all a bit excited. We've gone to Bali.
Just a little bit. Yeah. Just a tad.
An end-of-season footy trip to an island paradise. So too did Sydney's Coogee Dolphins. And that first night, they all headed to the Sari Club.
No, we're just sitting back chilling. We just had four or five tables and we're just sitting there laughing.
Within hours, their lives were torn apart when terror bombs ripped through Kuta's nighttime district.
People are burnt everywhere. I just don't believe what happened here tonight.
I turn around into the main road and it's chaos. It is sheer chaos. There's people stumbling around, there's people walking out of the Sari Club stumbling, other people are trying to help him out of the Sari Club.
2 decades on, again wearing his Kingsley Cats Bali tour shirt, Paul Adams was back.
Yeah, 20 years old, yeah, only put on 20 times.
Mourning his 7 teammates who never came home at a memorial service at the Australian Consulate General in Bali.
That was really good. Yeah, it was done well. Yeah, a lot of respect.
Around 300 loved ones, first responders and dignitaries joined survivors such as Andrew Charby.
Many bystanders had issued first aid without self-preservation and saved many of us.
He shared with them his daily mantra.
To expect trouble as an inevitable part of life, and when it comes, hold your head up high.
So many in Australia and Indonesia have refused to let terror win.
Today, our two nations are closer than ever, bound by a common grief and bound by a fierce conviction that terror should not be allowed to win.
Wrapping both our countries' hearts around those in need. Former AFP officer Andy Thorpe was here too, praising his Indonesian counterparts.
Love them like brothers and I'm going to be with them tonight, so terrific.
Here, where so many lost their lives, the site remains derelict. But so much has changed. Back then, the hospitals were overwhelmed and ill-equipped.
The hospital was mayhem.
Along what was once grim makeshift morgues, the hospital walkways lined with hundreds of broken bodies, now tread a new generation of highly trained doctors and nurses. And opposite rests a gift from the Australian people to the people of Indonesia, the 12 October Australian Memorial Centre. The global collaborations left a lasting impression on Dr. Fiona Wood. With her pioneering spray-on skin, she led the Aussie team that saved more than 50 victims medevaced back home.
Yeah, we've lived through something extraordinary. Have you ever lived through a time where everybody says yes, where everybody does their best and is just falling over themselves to do more?
Ali Donaldson joins us now live from Kuta. Ali, it's been a long day there and highly emotional. You're at the memorial site. What's happening there tonight?
Sandra, there's been some really beautiful preparations underway all day down here because between 6 and 9pm down at this site, local community groups will hold memorial services, largely prayer and spirituality and some performances. You can see there they've been building floral arrangements, stunning floral arrangements all day. And then between 10 and midnight tonight, Indonesian government ministers will hold a more formal service. Of course, at 11pm, it will be a lot cooler. It's very hot right now, and there'll be many more people down here because they're going to close off the roads, and we'd expect hundreds and hundreds of people down here to fall silent at the exact moment those bombs ripped through here 20 years ago.
We're special indeed. All right, Ali, thank you.